ఆత్మేనా ఆత్మని పశ్యంతి. ఇట్ ఇస్ అ కోట్ ఫ్రమ్ భగవద్గీత. ఇట్స్ అ కోట్ ఫ్రమ్ భగవద్గీత చాప్టర్ 13. ధ్యానేన ఆత్మని పశ్యంతి కేచిద్ ఆత్మానమాత్మన. బై మెడిటేషన్ యూ బిహోల్డ్ ద సెల్ఫ్ విత్ ఇన్ యువర్ సెల్ఫ్ బై యువర్ సెల్ఫ్. ది సియర్ ఇస్ ద సెల్ఫ్, ది ఆబ్జెక్ట్ ఇస్ ద సెల్ఫ్, ద ఇన్స్ట్రుమెంట్ ఇస్ ఆల్సో ద సెల్ఫ్. ద పర్పస్ ఆఫ్ మెడిటేషన్ ఈస్ టు ఫైనలీ ఓపెన్ ద డోర్ టు సెల్ఫ్ రియలైజేషన్. సెల్ఫ్ రియలైజేషన్ ఆర్ లిబరేషన్ ఆర్ మోక్ష ఆర్ ముక్తి ఆర్ సమాధి, వాట్ ఎవర్ ద టర్మ్స్ దట్ యూ యూస్ ఫర్ దట్, ద కీ టు ఇట్, ద ఫైనల్ డోర్ టు ఇట్ ఇస్ మెడిటేషన్. సో ఇన్ స్పిరిచువల్ కోర్స్ దిస్ ఇస్ ద పిహెచ్డి, దిస్ ఇస్ ద లాస్ట్ లెవెల్. బిఫోర్ యూ రీచ్ ద పిహెచ్డి లెవెల్ దెర్ ఆర్ వేరియస్ అదర్ లెవెల్స్ దట్ యూ హెవ్ టు గో త్రూ, అండ్ దెన్ దిస్ మేక్స్ సెన్స్. మెడిటేషన్ ఫర్ సచ్ అ పర్సన్ విల్ బీ అ వండర్ఫుల్ థింగ్ ఇన్ హిస్ హ్యాండ్. What disturbs the peace is actually the quantum of desires that we have. See, a plane is trying to take off, but the plane is overloaded with so many things that it has. I do not know. They have stuffed it with lot of load. Before taking off, there is a certain momentum that the plane gets on the runway. Unless otherwise it gets that momentum, it cannot take off. It's the same principle with which certain birds like wild geese and other thing, you will find that they fill themselves with a lot of weeds because they are going to migrate for a longer time over a greater distance. They completely fill themselves with that, if you want to call it aviation fuel, with that heavy load. Normally, when what flight they can do, they cannot do it now because they are heavily loaded. So on the surface of the water, they run for a while and then they take off. Once they take off, they cruise because they are going to travel a distance. Like that principle is this aeroplane. Now, if it is overloaded, if it cannot gain that momentum, it is impossible for the plane to take off. Therefore, you need to offload certain luggage. You have to offload certain weight from it. Exactly like that. Meditation is like taking off into a realm of transcendental. That is the purpose of meditation. Now our system is heavy with desires. With this heavy desires, if you want to run and take off in the practice of meditation, it is next to impossible. Therefore, one need to drop the bulk of desires to become meditative. So the first and foremost step, can we have the next chart? See, this diagram is there in, I think, in the new edition of Vedanta Treatise, or if you have the Bhagavad Gita book, I think in chapter 13, this diagram is given. Try to remember this diagram always. It's very, very important for us to understand the comprehensive sadhana here. Here, this samadhi state or om, it is written here, is the final state of enlightenment or realization. For reaching this goal or home, the key is the dhyana or meditation. Before meditation comes dharana. Dharana is an intense focus, and before that comes uparati. So uparati, dharana, dhyana constitute, you can say, what is known as antaranga sadhana or internal sadhana. This is for persons who are relatively introverts. Introverts means they are not absolutely liberated. They have a reasonable control over their personality by reduction of desires. They are able to do integrated sadhana now. Most of their mind is under their control. Still, they have certain higher desires to pursue, and they are the persons who are qualified to do these things. Majority of us, 90-95% of us, belong to this first phase. The first phase, you are called as a yogi. In the second phase, you are called as a sannyasi. In the last phase, you are called as a jnani. These are the terms used in Bhagavad Gita that I am using. Extroverted, introverted, realized. An extroverted person is one who has got many desires, maximum desires. You have interest in household activities, you have interest in money, entertainment, sense objects. This is the life of a majority of the people. Now he has understood that he has to control the mind or bring them spirituality into his life, which is fine. Therefore, what is the sadhana that is prescribed for him is that first he must offload the bulk of his desires, make himself reasonably, that could be a, what you call as a relative goal. A relative goal should be that he must at least reach a state of renunciation where he has a complete freedom while living in the world itself. Karma yoga is the actions that we do, how we convert that actions into worship that is done by the physical body. Bhakti yoga is the act of devotion where we use the mind. Jnana yoga is the path of knowledge. All these three also distinct and different in the stage of extrovert, where you do karma yoga doesn't mean you have to suddenly start doing social service and anything like that. You can continue to do your own office activities, household activities, but do it in the spirit of service and sacrifice. Then the karma becomes karma yoga. So by doing karma yoga, we actually reduce the quantity of desires. By doing bhakti yoga, we improve the quality of desires. By doing jnana yoga, we change the direction of desires. I repeat, karma yoga is responsible for reduction in the quantity of desires. Bhakti yoga improves the quality of desires. Jnana yoga, or path of knowledge, study and reflection, changes the direction of desires from extroversion to introversion, from terrestrial to transcendental. So by practicing these three, when you are able to reasonably offload the bulk of your desires, you become little light, then you become withdrawn. Withdrawal is a state where you are not bothered now too much about the world. You are not running after sensual enjoyments or anything. They don't attract you anymore. This is not trying to do and practice. This is a state. This is an effect. And then dharana is a deep focus or a complete area of concentration is now in the entire realm of the transcendental. When it comes to a single pointed thing, it is called as dhyana or meditation, through which you attain samadhi. Now, this is not something which is coined by our Swamiji or any master. It is a traditional knowledge. People who quote the scriptures and talk about meditation, they have to remember, wherever you see meditation being mentioned, be it Bhagavad Gita or be it any scripture, 100 out of 100 times before meditation, the preparation for meditation is either directly given or indicated. Unless otherwise that preparation is there, this person cannot meditate. If you are not able to see it, then, I mean, God be with you. It is not possible for a person to get into meditation without preparation. A few examples or a proof we will give now, so that this thought goes deep into our system, that preparation for meditation is much more important than actually sitting on the seat of meditation, because that is a very inspired state. Meditate, you will automatically do, but we have to try and get into the seat of meditation. Bhajagovindam, verse 30, famous verse. It says, pranayamam, pratyaharam, nitya nitya viveka vicharam, japya sameta samadhi vidhanam, kurvavadanam, mahadavadanam. The translation. Pranayamam, regulation of pranas, life activities. Pratyaharam, withdrawal of senses. Nitya anitya viveka vicharam, distinction, focus on distinction between eternal and ephemeral. This is the sequence. And then he says japya, japa, practice of chanting and silencing the mind. Samadhi, japya sameda samadhi vidhanam, kurvavadanam mahadavadanam. Do it with care, do it slowly, do it with great care. See, this is a practice where you are dealing with your internal personality. The care that you must take is much more than how you will deal with a nuclear science. Nuclear science, say, suppose if a person is trying to make a nuclear bomb or something, how much caution and how much care that he must take, because one mistake here or there can explode the whole thing. Similarly, when you are going to deeper recesses within your personality and dealing with your mind, dealing with your thoughts and opening up of whatever, you know, in Patanjali's Ashtanga Yoga, or some people talk about Kundalini and other things. In fact, we must not even talk about that, even for curiosity's sake. Even if a person is going to say, don't do all these things, then what did you say? You said about a word. You will forget everything. Kundalini. What is Kundalini? They will go into that only. It is unnecessarily to even incite a curiosity. That is why great masters never even talk about it publicly. What is the problem is, after the advent of the West, when they came here and opened up all our scriptures, and a translation was made and everything was made very easily for everybody. Now if you have to Google something, and you will get everything. So it is not that by secret they withheld this knowledge with others. They have to be very careful as to who is the adhikari who is receiving this knowledge. See, for example, if I ask you, I am new to Calcutta from here, let us say from this Chaurangi, I want to go to airport. How to go? I ask you. So what will you say? Sir, there are many ways to go. Either you can take a cab and go, or take a bus and go. You take a train, metro up to Damdam and go from there. Or if you have time, it is just for fun you are going, you can slowly cycle and go also. These are all the methods. These are all the ways that you will recommend, which is correct. Let us assume you know of some secret hidden path. Some king of this Bengal, many centuries ago, he had dug from, let us say, Toliganj to somewhere for their escape route. In those days, he had done it, and now it is not functional. Whether a person goes into it, whether he will come out alive also, you know, but you know about it. Now, when I am asking how to go out to airport, suddenly, why will you talk about that path? Now, there is also a path there in Toliganj. Don't go there. If you say, oh, is there a path? I'll go and try. Immediately my curiosity will be in. But when I go into it, whether I will come out of it alive in the present state, I really do not know. Now, the paths of this Kundalini and other thing is something like that. If there are one or two who are specifically designed for that and who can do that with the proper guidance of certain masters who are able to practice it, best of luck to them. Worship them from a distance. That's all. Otherwise, most people talk about this chakra coming here, I am not able to follow this, that. Be very, very careful about it, because kurvavadanam mahadavadanam. Do it with great care. When you are not able to have certain basic control over your personality, anger is not controlled, sense indulgence is not controlled, involving or invoking all these chakras, etc., it is not recommended at all. And those are the people who get frustrated after meditation. You have to be very, very careful with this. Bhajagovindam says, since we have talked about pranayama and pratyahara, we will go through these steps. Most people talk about this asanas, pranayama, and then get into meditation, which is correct. But what is important is, in the Ashtanga Yoga, what is given first two is important. We are in those basic levels that we have to have yama and niyama. Yama are certain codes of control that is recommended. Niyama are certain observances, certain practices that you must do. Once you do rigorously when you do that, then comes a stage where you can be in a posture where the body will be in your total control. That is asana. All of this you will simultaneously do, but you have to lay more emphasis on yama and niyama in the beginning. And then comes the body control, then comes the breath control. And then comes pratyahara, which is in the diagram you saw as uparati, sense, complete sense withdrawal. Then dharana, dhyana, samadhi is the same thing. Let us see what is yama and niyama. We are clean bold there. Ahimsa. Yama means you have to practice complete ahimsa. Satyam, truthfulness. Asteya, non-stealing. Brahmacharya, continence. A complete self-control over your own personality. Aparigraha, non-hoarding. You must not hoard anything just beyond your what is required. Where are we practicing all these things? These are yama. Niyama, early morning bath and purity at all levels, body level, mind level. Purity is when your mind cannot really believe that others can do you harm. That is the highest level of purity. Even if other person is vicious, you refuse to believe, not by effort, But your mind is so pure that you cannot even conceive that others can do you any harm. Can you imagine? That is purity. Austerity, tapas, concerted effort, swadhyaya, self-study, and then Ishvara Pranidhana, complete surrender to the Supreme Self. These are all the initial things where you are able to come into the path itself. Then comes pranayama, etc., postures and other things. Therefore, it is very clearly emphasized what is the qualifications required for to go into the Ashtanga Yoga itself. Then, Atma Bodha, verse 38. I am quoting just one verse here and there because we have studied this. Any scripture, any Upanishads, many places it is given, you will find these are the qualifications that will be there. Vivikta Desha Asinaha, Viragaha, Vijitendriyaha, Bhavayet Ekam Atmanam, Tam Anantam Ananyadihi. What it means is, seated in a solitary place. Nowadays we only have what is known as a group meditation. There is no such thing as group meditation. Seated in a solitary place, free from desire. Again and again, this is emphasized. Vijitendriya. Jitendriya is one who has conquered the senses. Vijitendriya, well conquered, with senses well controlled. One should meditate upon that one infinite Atman without any other thought. Very clear as to what is the procedure here. Next, chapter 6 of Bhagavad Gita, which talks about Dhyana Yoga. In the third verse itself, he says, Arurukshor Muner Yogam Karma Karana Muchyate Yoga Rudasya Tasyaiva Shamakarana Muchyate. For a seeker who wishes to master yoga, action is said to be the means. That's why Swami Ramtirtha also says there is lot much to be achieved in this ordinary state of action than in the exalted state of meditation. For a seeker, in the diagram that we saw erstwhile, Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Jnana Yoga, for person who is there, karma is the means. Karma means extroverted practices. Even the bhakti, jnana, everything that we do is action oriented. Once a person goes in the second stage, he becomes introverted, absorption oriented. So expression oriented is a yogi. For a person who wishes to master that yoga, action is said to be the means. Yoga rudasya. Aruda means mounted on. Gajaruda they say, na? Rishabha Aruda. Shiva is Rishabha Aruda. Rishabha means bull. Aruda means he is sitting on the bull. That means bull is under his perfect control. Garuda Aruda. Vishnu is Garuda Aruda. That means he has mounted on Garuda. Garuda is under full control. Similarly, a person who is sitting on yoga, that means yoga is under his control. That means a person who has crossed the initial space, that person is a Yoga Aruda. For him, quietude is said to be the means. Very clearly given. And in the next verse, he is going to define who is a Yoga Aruda. Yada hi ne indriya teshu na karma swanu shajyate sarva sankalpa sanyasi Yoga Aruda stadochyate. Who is a Yoga Aruda? Sarva sankalpa sanyasi. Yeah. When a man is not attached either to sense objects or actions and has renounced all sankalpas, then he is said to be established in yoga. Therefore, very clearly, wherever it is, one last thing, Upanishad, you put there, is a long mantra, but only follow the last one. He says, Atyashrami Sarvada Sakritva Japet. Sarvada means always, Sakritva means once, Japet means let him chant, let him meditate. Atyashrami is the key word here. Atyashrami means a person of the highest ashrama. Highest ashrama is nothing but sannyas ashrama. So meditation requires nothing sort of sannyas. When I say sannyas, it is not that you have to put on a akar robe and take up sannyas. Come to this thing. What it means is a mental state of renunciation. There are people who have achieved that state even in household also. There are people who have taken up sannyas because nowadays you have gurus giving sannyas left, right, center, and many people are getting diksha and going into meditation without actual preparation. That is why the term Sadguru is a very, very recent coinage. When I say recent, it is not there in the Upanishad times. In the Upanishad times and other things, only in Gita also, what is given is Guru. Guru means Guru. Now, why there should be a qualification called Sadguru? That means some other type of gurus are also there now. That is why Sadguru is there. So, when people are not qualified, so our Paramaguru Swami Chinmayananda was not given Diksha by his Guru Tapovan Maharaj when he wanted to take up. He said, do sadhana for some more time. If that is the case for Swami Chinmayananda, where are we? Now, we have to be very careful. So, Atyashrami means a person who has attained the state of renunciation, for him, meditation becomes a means, quietude of mind he can practice. Now, this is not really to discourage or give a pessimistic feeling to all of us that we must never attempt this or something. There is ways and means to do it. First of all, we have to understand why is there this craze about meditation.
Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.